Hello, because strings are super important, we have loads of different ways we can manipulate and perform different operations on our strings. We've looked at slicing and concatenation already. Let's look at five more in this video. So the first three we'll cover are dot length, dot upper, and dot lower. Well, dot length we've used before, and I've shown you it in examples before. This gives you how many characters a string has. We also use dot length with arrays. Dot upper will give you the uppercase version of your string. And dot lower will give you the lowercase version of your string. All of these are useful. All of these are used really often, so you need to be comfortable with them either in ERL or in your own programming language. Let's look at a couple of examples of how these might get used. We're going to here ask the user for the name of their school. We're told it must be longer than two characters, so we're going to keep asking until it is longer than two characters. We've got to use a condition-controlled iteration structure here because we don't know how many times it's going to loop. But I'm going to need to use dot length to figure out how long the string is. So I'm using do until here, you could use a while loop. I'm asking for the school name, user input is always a string, so school name is a string, and I'm using dot length to calculate how long this input is. If it's greater than two, that means it's valid, that means we can continue. If it's not greater than two, the do until loop will just repeat and repeat and repeat until it is eventually longer than two characters. Let's give another example where we use upper. So we're gonna ask the user to enter a postcode. Output invalid if the letters within it are not capitalized. Output valid if they all are. Here, we don't need to have a loop because we're just going to say either invalid or valid. So just an if statement will be sufficient. But how are we going to tell if the user's postcode is capitalized or not? Well, we can't in an easy way unless I use dot upper or indeed dot lower. So here's how I would do it. I'm going to ask the user for their postcode first of all. Then in my if statement, my condition is postcode.upper is equal to postcode. If it is equal, we're going to say valid, else we're going to say invalid. Well, how does this work? Well, if I type in, say, NW1, for example, with an NW in lowercase, well, postcode.upper would make this become uppercase. So it would convert any letters into uppercase. And now NW1 is not equal to NW1 in lowercase, therefore this is false, therefore it says invalid. However, if I type in N17 with a capital N, postcode.upper would also give us N17 because N was already capitalized, and this was equal to the original value of postcode, which was N17. So this is now equal, and it would run valid. So the upper doesn't change it to be uppercase, it just gives you the uppercase version of it, which allows you to compare it later. Because this is used so often, let's do a third and final example where we're going to ask for you to enter what the capital of France is. We're going to keep asking until they get it correct. Case of the answer shouldn't matter. It shouldn't matter if they say Paris lowercase or uppercase or the capitalized P or whatever it is, doesn't matter. As long as the word is Paris. Well, I need a while loop here or a do until loop because we don't know how many times it will take for them to get it right. But we're going to ask for input. And this time I'm using lower, you could use upper if you want to. But what I'm doing is I'm forcing the answer, no matter what it is, to be lowercase. So I'm using dot lower to force it to become lowercase. I'm then comparing it to Paris in lowercase. And if the lowercase version is not equal to Paris in lowercase, they must have got it wrong. Therefore, I'm asking again. So no matter what they type in, if they type in a capital P, if they type in the whole answer in capital, or they type in none of it in capitals, or they do something really weird, they capitalize some of it, but not others. This would all be treated consistently because it's all being forced to be lowercase, and it's the lowercase version we are comparing for consistency reasons. The final thing related to strings we're going to talk about isn't used as often as the stuff I've covered so far, but it could come up in the exam, so you have to be aware of it. This relates to ASCII conversion. ASCII is our character set in paper one. It's our main way of representing English characters in a computer. Unicode contains ASCII, remember? Each character has got a character code. And here is a snippet of the ASCII table where I've got all my characters on the left-hand side. I'm just showing you the uppercase ABZ and lowercase ABZ, but they are sequential, so we'd have all the letters between these gaps. All of these codes have got a character code. Now this character code is in binary, so it stores it in binary in the computer. It's how you represent letters in binary. However, binary is not very helpful to us as humans, so we often represent character codes in deanery. So the far right column here is what you're more likely to be seeing when dealing with characters in a computer. And there are tools in ERL and most languages to convert between character codes and the character, almost always using deanery, not binary. So ASC in capitals with brackets, when it is given a character in the bracket, it finds out what is its character code. So if I wrote ASC with a capital A, this would give us 65. CHR, short for character, when it's given a character code, it tells you what character this is. So if I had CHR with 98 in the brackets, this would give me lowercase b. To give you an example of where you might need to use one of these, well, let's say we're asking the user to enter a character. We're going to output valid if it is a letter and output invalid if it is not a letter. So we could use our knowledge of the ASCII table, also our knowledge of these two subprograms to be able to do this check, which will just be an if statement. It's either going to be valid or invalid. Well, how do I check? Here's how I would go about doing it. I'm asking for the character. I'm then finding the ASCII code for that character. So I'm using the ASC subprogram here. CHR is used less often, but it could be used. But here I'm finding out the character code for this character. I'm then using, it's not my memory because I wouldn't ever memorize this, it'd be given in the exam, but I'm using my knowledge of how the codes work in ASCII. They are sequential. So the capital letters are between 65 and 90. So these are kind of one half of our letters. And the second half of our letters are the lowercase letters, which are 97 to 122. We have this annoying kind of seven letter gap in the middle here. So if the code is bigger than or equal to 65 and less than or equal to 90, this must mean it is an uppercase letter. But also valid are the lowercase letters. So if the code is bigger than or equal to 97 and less than or equal to 122, this must be a lowercase letter. And so either one of these sides being true means this is a valid letter. If it's outside of this range, it can't be a letter. It must be a number. It must be a symbol. It must be something else. So therefore, only the lowercase and uppercase letters are valid letters.